The last case is a little bit comparison between technologies. I wanted Dr. Ramurthy and Dr. Gaurav also to be here because we are all using technologies which is just not Alcon. So there are some insights which all of us should know, in especially when you are dealing with newer technologies. So I don't think there's been ever been a machine which is made which is bad. And I think all machines have their own inherent strength. The first discussion we have is about the concept of what is stronger or what is weaker. If we ask the group here, the major problem which is comes to you is when you're dealing with any procedure is, we are doing a weaker procedure because we are cutting a flap, or we are making a stronger eye because we are doing a smile. So I think this is a very important paper which came out just a few months back, and we're happy that it was the editor's pick at AAO last month or this month as the biomechanics of LASIK flap and cap. I'll just go give a small insight in how we did this paper. What we did was we took just hold on here. The same patient, we did the flap, we did the smile, but we did not do the procedure. That means the patient just had a flap, we did not laser him. The patient had the complete smile, but we did not take the lenticule. Basically, the eye just remained intact apart from just cutting the flap. The question comes, we took this patient, I did the same assessment, the mathematical modelings and the biomechanics of this patient at 4 hours. And then what we did was we did the regular surgery, like how you do a smile or cap. So what we wanted to study is, by just cutting the flap without actually doing the laser, how much does the eye become weaker? Or just making the lenticule without taking the lenticule out, how much would it become weaker? And people said that the flap makes your weak cornea really weak compared to the smile, which we've been all been told to, or all been told to believe. So I'll just jump into this. So this is something which everybody knew. You make a cut of LASIK, your biomechanically it drops, it cornea becomes weaker. The smile, absolutely nothing. So this is, everybody knows about it. So it's great news for smile users, like a lot of us. But the entire modeling, which Sisimosis will agree, go back, is based on this concept here. It doesn't, the modeling of mathematics doesn't factor in the concept that the eye can heal, the eye can get better. There are tissues, there are wound healing pathways. So we did the same patient, we did continuously over the next 6 months, we measured them continuously. This, and it was a repeatable one, there's more than 35, Pooja did the study. And at 6 months, this is something which the Zeiss doesn't like to see, or anybody doesn't like to see. 6 months, there's no difference between smile and LASIK. Your wound healing has done so well, your smile and LASIK are bang on. And this was the same patient of contralateral eye study. That means the weakness, which was 18-fold when you make a flap, the LASIK suddenly recovers very differently. It suddenly believes that there has been a cut on the body. That is how a body recovers, you know. If I have a cut on the body, all the mechanism in the body just starts working on to repair that cut. Immediately, the cut makes you weaker. But within 3 months, the cut is completely closed. That is how a body wound healing happens. And exactly the same thing, the body response to cut is exactly the same. Compared to smile, where there's no wound healing at all. It's just weakness out there. So with this paper, we opened up a completely new dimension that it is not, and in the same platform last month, John Marshall was there and asked him the question, do you still think it is a stronger procedure? Very quietly he said, no. It is not a stronger procedure. PRK, yes, but not smile. So that means what we have been talking about, that, you know, this cornea doesn't look so healthy to me, let's do a smile, just does not work, at least after this proof. Dr. Ramurthy, sir? See, this is, we use the Corvis, we use the Pentacam, And if you go back to that mathematical, it's exactly the same modeling. Can you put that Abhijit's paper somewhere? This is how the whole modeling worked. This modeling was exactly done when they said that it is stronger. So there was no argument about this paper because we used the same person who did it, same person did it for us also. He's not there today. You have his paper?
I quite agree with you. I think there was always a concept that smile is stronger than conventional LASIK, I mean biomechanically. And it was essentially because of Dan Einstein's mathematical model as well as some...
same models.
Same.
But sir, so, Dan Einstein's mathematical model, if you go back to that graph again,
and
see this model on Dan Einstein, Cynthia Roberts, which says that it's weeping. You met Sisymosis, you met him yesterday. This was a model on which it was based that it is stronger. And this model was looking at the acute response. So the mathematical model can never pick up a chronic response. So just remember this model for a second, and let's go back to that graph, then I'll come back to you.
Okay. No, I thought this is slightly different in the sense that here they take a finite element technology.
Exactly,
where they
the same thing, sir. Same thing we also did.
Dan Einstein in his calculation assumes that the corneal cap still offers a certain amount of stability to the cornea.
So what he says is, if you have a LASIK flap, what he says is your cornea on the posterior surface becomes very weak compared to smile, where it both sides are weaker, and compared to this, where both are weaker, both are the same. What this map was based on the assumption that an acute, what happens when you get an acute insult? For example, go back to the slide. Go back to the slide, not this. The 18-fold change. It matched this because it was an immediate post-op change. Your mathematical model never looks at a chronic change. It only looks at what happens immediately, which match exactly the same way. That there is a weakness compared to here, this complete drop, here there was no change. So, but what the modeling can never do is, the next slide, is how does it change over time? Because the mathematical modeling cannot predict it. Over time, this and this becomes the same.
I'm more impressed by the fact that you said John Marshall agreed to this, because he came out with a paper where he said the more than the horizontal flap cut is the vertical cut which really
But none of their models have never been tested on the human eyes, because all the models were tested on an hypothetical model, and we all were believing the same thing. But actually when you do it here, you actually start believing it differently because the wound healing things were never been credited for this.
So Rohit, are we trying to, this is very impressive and it's, I think, path-breaking research. But what I'm wondering is that, you know, we always keep saying that the LASIK flap does not ever contribute anything to the strength of the cornea, but this seems to, you know, speak otherwise. It's regained the strength.
It may not give the strength, but the cornea itself may be gaining
the
strength.
The hysteresis has improved. Now, what I'm wondering is that why we are seeing this change in the LASIK flap, you said, because, you know, the response of the tissues. So how is the response of the tissues different? Because in one laser, you've just used a femtosecond laser to create a flap. In the other, you've used it to fashion that lenticule. And is there the eczema scarring or some eczema reaction which has a role to play here?
I'll just put a slide about how this is not very clear, use the magnify. When we looked at a study from tear proteins from the same patient from one eye which is LASIK, the other eye to the smile, this answers your question from the cell biology, that is every single protein which is mentioned here is different in smile versus LASIK. For example, Santoferrin. Swami is here. Please, I mean, he's the man who did this from the lab, so he should. You please come there, please. I'm the wrong person. Come. Swami is a cell biologist and he does signaling pathways. So all this were done from the patients who had a smile in one eye and LASIK in the other eye. And just can you explain briefly, very briefly, about question which Gaurav asked about why do you think there should be a differential response of healing?
Absolutely. So the surgical process did induce a difference in both LASIK and SMILE. All the single arrows, that's what it means. Okay? There is a distinct differences. You have the double arrows and the triple arrows. The magnitude is different. So you see double arrows and triple arrows. And once again, over months, it's different. If I can summarize, these proteins, which are in yellow, have a distinct difference in magnitude as well as in the kinetics, which is unique to either LASIK or SMILE.
So what he's trying to say is, these proteins are like ocular hemostasis. They help in healing. So you can see that early stage of LASIK, it's low. Suddenly, it starts becoming better. In SMILE, it is just the same, more or less not much of a change. And inflammation, again, changes a lot. And if you can look at the tissue remodeling, which is here, which is completely different in SMILE compared to LASIK. So what happens is LASIK and SMILE don't have the same wound healing. So that's why they don't behave the same. Probably SMILE behaves differently initially, but the LASIK suddenly picks up over time.
So I think I have to just move to the next, sorry.
So before we go further, so just to keep it simple, so basically the LASIK initially, because not much of scarring or healing has happened between the flap, so the strength of the flap is completely excluded from the cornea. But over time, once that healing happens, the hold between the flap and the rest of the cornea becomes stronger. So that's a simple way to say why it's so significantly different in the early phase and the later phase, because the bond between or the strength at which the rest of the cornea holds the flap is much stronger at a later months.
I think it would be really interesting to go beyond the study and start do similar study on PRK and microkeratome flaps.
Absolutely.
That would really give us shed so much more light, because if it's just to differentiate between LASIK and PRK, there you are using two lasers, the femtosecond and the excimer. In the PRK, you would only be using excimer, although the logistics would completely change because the ocular surface and everything would be affected. And
Absolutely.
Then looking at microkeratome, comparing it to the femtosecond flap and LASIK, and PRK to LASIK and SMILE, and looking at these parameters and the the proteins, and try to see what is, I mean, four columns would be even more interesting, I think.
Absolutely,
What we believe is there is a hidden scar in healing in a LASIK which we don't see. If you do a confocal microscopy on them, you see at the stromal level a very faint scar which is around 8 to 10 microns. It's not causing disturbance to you in any way, but it's definitely there, which is kind of holding on the cornea, becoming not more weaker than what it should be.
For that matter, all of us have experienced years later lifting up a femtolasic flap is much more difficult than lifting up a microkeratome flap. And also, even at the edges, there's supposed to be a double healing, while there's a single line of healing is what you microkeratome.
So basically, to sum up on this particular thing, if somebody comes and tells us that I do this because it's biomechanically stronger, I don't think that holds good anymore. It's great in many ways, no flap, faster recovery. I'm sure all three of us agree here. It's a wonderful procedure, but definitely not a procedure where you want to avoid an ectasia, and or you don't want to do a PRK. There are times people say, I don't like to do a PRK, that's why I'll do a SMILE. I think that's a terribly wrong concept to do.
I think what Rohit is trying to say is that case selection for LASIK and SMILE is identical.
Absolutely.
We don't want to say that if you would rather do SMILE than LASIK on a patient just because something on the cornea looked different. And I think your case selection should be absolutely identical, and that's what I
absolutely.
Follow.
Absolutely. Yeah. As similar to what you see in LASIK.
I think totally agree. But I think one aspect where a patient is in the army or his profession is boxing or something, between LASIK and SMILE, I think
I
that would be the better
that.
Instead
so
of the PRK.
In those cases, go for PRK.
PRK yeah. So if PRK is one kind which patient doesn't want that option, he wants because of whatever
no, I think
phobia for
pain. What Narin brought out is actually so important. When we're looking at flap complications, then there's a huge difference between SMILE and LASIK. And if you're not looking at biomechanical stability per se or risk of ectasia, if I had to choose SMILE between SMILE and LASIK, I would 100% choose SMILE. The risk of flap complications being so much lower or non-existent with SMILE, I think it has a huge benefit over LASIK in that way, even when these two things are identical or whatever.
This is the last case, it's something which both Dr. Ramamurthy and me were involved in this. This is Dr. Ramamurthy, I think this is your case, so you can just discuss, then we can stand in the center.
Oh, my contribution was only creating the ectasia and supplying you the tears. So you know more about it, please go ahead.